Hi, and welcome to my talk. If you bill it, they will pay. Energy consumption in the cloud will be irrelevant until directly billed for. This is a talk by me, Abram Hindle, from Department of Computing Science, University of Alberta, Canada, which is about 3 hours, 4 hours from Banff. All right. So, why do we care about energy? Well, typically, energy consumption is related to global warming in the sense of CO2 production as well as the burning of coal. So this also includes pollution such as PPM 2.5 particles and things like that. So in general, the more energy you consume, especially in Edmonton, the more you pollute the entire environment. As well as, even if you did have renewables, you'd still have to build the generators and that would actually extract the renewable energy, and those have a cost as well. Furthermore, when you do computation, you typically convert information and energy into heat and information. Heat is generally a byproduct that we don't want, and typically to deal with heat, we have to cool things with things like fans and air conditioners and water coolers and stuff like that. In this presentation, I'm mostly going to focus on the cloud and server-side computing. But for mobile computing, energy is a big sustainability and reliability issue because if you run out of energy in terms of batteries, you typically don't get to use your computer anymore. So it's a very noticeable hit. And for software developers, they're directly motivated to address battery use on their apps, because if someone complains on the App Store that their app uses too much of their battery, typically people will listen and the app will not be used that much. Furthermore, typically energy is billed for. For instance, after all the distribution fees in Edmonton, I pay about 12 to 14 cents per kilowatt hour. So, how do computers actually consume energy? Well, typically you've got software. Software runs on the CPU, and it tells the CPU and other peripherals like memory, disk, network, GPS, GPUs, all that kind of stuff, to go and do something. Okay? So the command of software doesn't really consume the energy. It's typically the hardware, but the software tells it what to do. The components that typically consume the most energy are things like the CPU, the memory, and the disk, and the network, and GPUs. In this diagram, I've got lots of different examples, but typically your CPU is your number one consumer. Anytime you use the bus, you use a lot of energy because you have to do high-speed communication on the bus, and that signaling doesn't come free. When you access memory, you have to keep, not only do you have to keep the memory going, but you actually have to talk to the bus. When you access a disk, you have to use the bus again, but you also need to use a peripheral such as like a SSD or a spinning disk to actually store information. Network, like Ethernet, typically doesn't use that much electricity until you get into high bandwidth scenarios. Once you get there, then the IOPS really hurt. Then there's also wireless, which requires you to charge up antenna and things like that, and GPS require the same thing, and that uses a lot of energy as well. So typically peripherals and GPUs and things like that use energy as well. In a data center, there is a push for dealing with energy consumption because Song et al. Report that 40% of energy spent is actually on cooling. So if you've got a 100-watt system, you're probably going to spend 40 watts cooling that system. How does this affect the cloud? Well, cloud providers such as Amazon AWS and Microsoft's Azure and all that, they typically bill for what they can measure. And they have all these counters, and they then bill you for all the things that they counted. And these things will be like CPU hours, the quality of the CPU, utilization, IO operations, storage. And so the issue is that typically customers are billed for what is measured. And if you bill for something you can't directly measure, will customers actually revolt? So here's an example. So this is from my friend. My friend, he's got a company, and they spend about $6,000 a month on AWS. So they use a whole wide variety of Amazon Web Services, from databases to compute cloud to caches to Elasticsearch to Redshift, all sorts of things. And it gets broken down. You can see that it gets broken down by load balancing, hours, it gets broken down by using a NAT. Basically, like, it's like you've rented a little router. It gets broken down by CPU hours on different machines. You can see that some machines are very popular. He's got 25,000 hours on one small small instance. There's not that many hours in a month. You've got different compute clouds. They pay hourly for different operating systems, and they pay for I/O. They pay in terms of gigabytes. They pay in terms of I/O operations. All of these things, and they eventually add up. Like, this is just the Elastic Cloud, and this is 2.5K. So when I talk to people who develop software and are in these scenarios, they say we care. But unless the customer asks, they typically won't prioritize for it. So they care, but it's not really a feedback that they get from their cloud provider. And it's not really a requirement that bubbles up from the customer. So if the customer is not there to actually request it, does it actually exist? Or are they motivated to put time and effort into addressing it? Customers, well, like me, care, but I personally lack the feedback and incentive to act on it, but I also lack awareness of choices and awareness of options that me as a customer can do in terms of cloud computing and things like that, and energy consumption and sustainability. So we do have this sustainability NFR, but it doesn't seem like it translates economically. And that's my big argument, is the economic perspective, that we're really not going to care about these things until we actually feel the hit from them, until I actually get billed for it. And one way that we could get billed for it without even realizing it is simply carbon taxes and other kinds of sustainability taxes. The government can actually impose things where other providers, like the cloud provider or the vendor, would be it'd be in their best interest to push that cost back down to the customer, such that the customer paid it and could act on that price signal. So if we did want to push energy consumption down onto the customer in the cloud, we'd have to actually measure the energy consumption of their services. And for something like a normal server, that's pretty easy. You just get in between it and its power source and you just measure it. You measure the amperage and voltage and you're good to go. But for a virtual machine, it's a virtual machine. It doesn't actually exist. There's no power plug I can get in the way of. So really what it is that it's part of your hardware, and part of your time on the hardware is dedicated to these virtual machines, and you basically have to measure these things, and they're shared on the same device. And in fact, some of the relationships can be kind of nonlinear, and it's not that fun. So what typically is done is you measure the utilization of different components like CPU, memory, network, disk, GPU, what have you, and then you produce these count-based models whereby you're suggesting that CPU use is worth so much, memory use is worth so much, network use is worth so much, disk is worth so much, and then that all adds up into energy, like joules or watt hours. So you could have a high CPU job that didn't really use a lot of disk or memory, or network, and that could actually be less costly than a job that actually used all the peripherals at once. So back to the problem. Maybe the customer won't pay for modeled energy. Maybe they only want to do things that are directly measured. Yes, I would not really like to rely on your model. But, you know, to be honest, I get billed for water that way in my city. And furthermore, governments have managed to levy carbon taxes without direct measurement. So, sustainability. It is the next NFR. It's coming right up. And it's not quite here yet. It's here in mobile, but it's not, especially with energy, but it's not really here in terms of service providers and cloud providers. And I don't think it will be until cloud providers start seeing the taxation and they're incentivized to actually put this on the bill and count the cooling costs on the bill rather than just wrapping them into CPU hours. And so you're going to see them do that. If they keep it separate from CPU hours, it will allow people to actually optimize against it. If it's just CPU hours, then it's just going to overly focus on CPU and ignore other peripherals. Whereas it would make more sense to have a better model whereby you actually estimate the energy consumption and the cooling, and maybe even just a separate cooling model, such that you could bill appropriately. But nonetheless, the government can incentivize via taxation and other things to make the cloud providers, vendors, and customers care about sustainability. And cloud providers themselves can actually make vendors and customers care about sustainability by directly billing vendors, such that that cost can be pushed down to the consumer and that they know what the overhead on the cost is and what the externalities are. So really what's going on here is it's not truly a software issue. It's more of an acceptance of energy modeling such that you can bill vendors and customers. It's a lack of push from the customers in the service arena to care about sustainability, mostly because they don't have to pay for it yet. But if the government makes the vendor pay for it or the customer pay for it, both will be able to optimize against it. And if the cloud provider has to pay for it, they will, of course, push the cost down on their vendors because they really love this itemized billing. And so they're going to bill you for everything under the sun that they can. So they'll probably start doing this. But it is a big relationship. You have push from requirements from the bottom. You have maybe the push from requirements from the top. I don't know if we're going to ever see legislation about the efficiency of software. Kind of hope not. But we'll definitely see legislation about carbon emissions and carbon taxes. And so we'll see this kind of push. So it's really a relationship between all these three. So nonetheless, what I was talking about here today is I talked about the importance of energy consumption that is caused by software and hardware. I talked about the costs of cooling and the difficulties in measuring these things. I talked about the relationship between cloud providers, the government, customers, and vendors in terms of making sustainability an actual requirement. And I argued that it will not be a requirement until you can actually get the feedback of it. Until you have a signal that tells you, oh, sustainability is saving you money, you're not going to do anything about it for the most part. Only certain people who are very concerned about sustainability will operate on this. So unless there is a clear economic signal, I don't see sustainability as an NFR becoming all that important unless you're in special areas like mobile computing and things like that. So in summary, the easiest thing right now is for governments to push down the sustainability costs, especially carbon, onto cloud providers and data centers and energy utilities such that they can push it back down onto vendors and customers. When customers feel the pinch, it will become a first-class requirement and people will actually start addressing it. And maybe people actually start choosing between services based upon their sustainability and their footprint. All right. Thank you for your time.